Good morning. Welcome to the church at West Franklin. We have around an hour together. We've had so much time all week doing all the things that we've been doing. And now in this moment, we have just one moment together for God to do something in our hearts, for us to be reminded of who God is in our lives. So I want to invite you to stand with me. Let's sing a hymn that will help us put God in the proper place in our heart as we worship Him together. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall and bring forth a royal diadem and crown Him Lord of all. Bring forth a royal diadem and crown Him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fall. Heal Him who saves you by His grace and crown Him Lord of all. Heal Him who saves you by His grace and crown. The King of so much for singing. Please be seated. I want to welcome you guys to the church at West Franklin, and I pray that that is what is on your heart, at least the direction of your heart and its affections this morning is towards Jesus. We have just a little bit of time together. I believe that those of us who are gathered in this room watching online will be shaped by this very moment. God can use this moment in your life to set the course for your future, and I pray that that would happen this morning. We're going to handle a moment that typically happens now when we would ask the ushers to come forward. We're not doing that today. Instead, if you've come prepared to give an offering, there will be some white boxes. You can turn and look right now. There's some white boxes back there by the door. If you've come prepared to give an offering, just drop it in that white box as you go. And if you have not come prepared to give an offering, maybe bring one next week. Those same boxes will be there. If you have yet to give, maybe next week could be the first week that you do that, because we have sung so much about Jesus being King, the King of heaven over it all. And one of the ways we practice that in the most visceral, I think, ways is in what we do with our money. When we give that away, give it to the kingdom of God and its work, we're slowly chipping away at an idol that so easily entangles our hearts. So I would encourage you, if you come prepared to give, please put it in the white box. And next week, if you haven't given yet, think about how you might chip away at that specific idol by giving to the kingdom's work here in the city of Franklin. Let me take a moment and let's pray together. Pastor Matt's going to come here in just a moment after this prayer and bring the word from the book of Revelation. And I pray that we would have ears to hear what the Spirit revealed to John about where all of history is headed. Father, we come to you now and we need your help to understand what is going on in these times and in the times to come. I pray this morning that through your word, you would show us how powerful you really are, how present you really are. And we just need your help to see these things. So we ask for your help. We ask for your Spirit to illuminate our hearts and to resonate within our spirit with what's true. So Father, help us now. King of heaven, you are here. Help our hearts to know that you have come down. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. Good morning. If you have your Bibles, take your copy and turn with me to the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible. We're going to start by looking at a verse in chapter 19, and then another verse or two in chapter 22, just to kind of some brackets around what we want to look at this morning. Don't fret. I'm not going to preach for 50 minutes. They're going to come back. The text just kind of lends itself to, I hope and pray, a season of worship after the message. So we're going to spend some more time singing when and if I get done. As you're turning to Revelation, just a couple of notes of interest to you, perhaps. Most of you know how you can get the bulletins. You can get information delivered right to your phone. Text the word bulletin to 623-623. On that, you're going to see starting August 10th, which is on a Wednesday night, we're going to be starting back ministries here in the life of the church, stuff for children, stuff for teenagers. For adults, there's different studies, but two new ones we're bringing up is one is Cults and World Religions study that we led by Josh Lynn. And then another for parents, parents of children, parents of teenagers, talking about just hopefully giving us some wisdom on how to navigate these days. We'll be talking about anything from social media to sexuality to mental health, that kind of thing. And so bringing people in from the outside to walk us through some of that. But that starts August the 10th, go from 6 to 7:15, and I'm very, very excited about these studies. Speaking of students, by the way, our student minister, Lindsay Gordon, is hosting Christmas in July at her house for students tonight. And so they do live in my neighborhood, so bring by a pie on your way if you'd like. Don't stay, but bring a pie or a cake or something like that. Just sit at front porch, contactless would be fine, and just can go. But if you have a student, I know they'd have a good time tonight celebrating Christmas in July. All right, Revelation. Hopefully you found Revelation chapter 19, and God willing, all the scriptures that I refer to will be on the screen behind me here, and there are a lot of scriptures we're going to look at. But to get us going, let me ask you to stand in honor of God's word, and let's start by reading verse 10 of chapter 19 and then a verse or two in chapter 22. John, inspired of the Spirit, said this, verse 10. Then I fell at his feet to worship him, but he said to me, "Don't do that. I am a fellow servant with you and your brothers and sisters who hold firmly to the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, because the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy." Chapter 22, verse 8. "I, John, am the one who heard and saw these things. When I heard and saw them, I fell down to worship at the feet of the angel who had shown them to me. But he said to me, 'Don't do that. I'm a fellow servant with you, your brothers, the prophets, and those who keep the words of this book. Worship God.'" Father, may we do exactly that. Lead us this morning and for the rest of our lives to be a people who worship you. Guard us against from ever worshiping good things. May we worship you, the ultimate thing, being. Help us stir our hearts, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated. John is a lot more humble than I would ever be, and I am. If I had been rebuked by an angel for worshiping the wrong thing twice, I don't think I would have written it down for anybody to know. Maybe once, but twice. Twice, he falls down to worship. And he, of all people, knows to worship God and God alone, but he falls down to worship an angel. An angel rebukes him and says, "Don't worship me, worship God." And he felt the need to write it down so that the people, the churches in Asia, when they saw him, could maybe tease him about it. And I think about that, I'm thinking, okay, all scripture's inspired of God. Why did he write that twice? And I can't help but think that John is saying, "The visions that God gave me are so overwhelming, I couldn't help it. I just acted out of character. It's so breathtaking. The grace is so immeasurable that I started acting in ways that I didn't know what to do with myself." Have you ever gone to a sporting event and you're surrounded by tons of strangers, most of which get on your nerves most of the game or whatever it is, and then your team does something amazing or wins, and you find yourself hugging these complete strangers, high-fiving them? Like, just seconds ago, you're like, "If they don't shut up." But then your team does, and you're like hugging them, and you're like, "Oh, that was awkward, but yeah!" And you keep doing it. I just wonder if John was having one of those moments. He's like, "Oh, this is amazing. I worship you." I don't know. But perhaps. Because what he sees here, what he says he saw here, is so breathtaking. You just wonder if he's like, "I don't know what to do with myself anymore." You do know that John's not out to write a timeline of how things are going to unfold. This happens now, and then this happens here, and then this happens here, and then this happens here. He's not writing to give us a diagram, a well-thought-out diagram of dates and times and people that we need to look for, because anybody you don't like in the political world, you're going to think is the Antichrist. His goal is not to give us a strict timeline or diagram. His goal is to explode our imaginations with what's really going on and what is going to go on. His goal is to so speak, so write what he saw that we're just shocked at how hard some of it can be, but more than anything, how amazing it can be. Isn't it interesting that John never got overwhelmed and fell down in fear when he saw the hard stuff? He gets overwhelmed and he falls down and worships, even in a way he shouldn't, when he saw the beautiful stuff. The beautiful grace of Jesus is far greater than the grossness of evil and Satan and the beasts. And that's really good news. John writes to explode our imaginations, not write a timeline. For instance, in chapter 19, if you've read it recently, you'll see that there is food and then a fight. Not a food fight. There's a banquet that we're invited to. Then we go out into a battle. There's a time where they break bread together, and then they're told to go out and break legs. Not really, but I wanted to keep the thing. Why? Because when I read the scripture and I read that I'm invited to a banquet, I think, here it comes. Here's how it's going to be. I can finally relax. But then he talks about a fight. Let me show it to you. Look in chapter 19, verse 7. Chapter 19, verse 7. Let us be glad, rejoice, and give him glory, because the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has prepared herself. She was given fine linen to wear, bright and pure, for the fine linen represents the righteous acts of the saints. Then he said to me, verse 9, write, blessed are those invited to the marriage feast of the Lamb. He also said to me, these words of God are true. Now I read that and I think, okay, we're getting to the climax. We're getting to the end where we're invited to a feast, we're invited to a banquet, we're going to be able to break bread together around the supper, around the table of the Lamb, the groom and Christ, the bride, which is us. It's going to be fascinating, right? Ah, yes. But then the next few verses talk about a fight. Let's look at it together. Verse 11. Look at verse 11. Then I saw heaven opened, and there was a white horse. And its rider is called Faithful and True, and he judges and makes war with justice. His eyes were like a fiery flame, and many crowns were on his head. Look at verse 14. The armies that were in heaven followed him on white horses, wearing pure white linen. A sharp sword came from his mouth so that he might strike the nations with it. Wait a second, I thought we were sitting down to a feast. Now we got to fight? I thought we were going to this nice banquet and we were just going to celebrate and eat. And now you reveal the guy on the white horse who's coming out with his armies behind him. I just want to eat. And you want to talk about an intense battle. A back and forth, a back and forth, a back and forth. Look how intense this battle is in verse 19. Just watch. Then I saw the beast, the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to wage war against the rider and the horse and against his army. But the beast was taken prisoner, and along with it the false prophet who had performed the signs in its presence. Thanks. I don't know if y'all are paying attention just now. Did you see how intense that battle was? In 1995, I was a senior in high school. Mike Tyson was just blowing everybody out of the water in boxing. My favorite game on the Nintendo Entertainment System was Mike Tyson's Punch-Out. The only way you could watch boxing back then was pay-per-view. My dad would not let me buy it because it cost too much. And it was usually on Saturday night, and Dad said Saturday Night Live is Sunday morning dead. So I had to go to bed on Saturday night. But in my senior year in high school, Mike Tyson was supposed to fight Peter McNeely at the MGM Grand in Las Vegas. Millions of people were watching the fight. Millions of people paid millions of dollars to watch the fight. Mike Tyson, Peter McNeely. I don't even know who Peter McNeely is, but everybody was paying for it and watching it. That fight lasted a minute and 37 seconds. And within that minute and 37 seconds, McNeely had already been knocked down twice before he was knocked out. It was no fight. But it was a minute and 37 seconds longer than this one. And then Satan and the beast rise up to attack the one on the horse. Over. That's it. I'm like,
Because I hear so many people, the devil made me do it. The devil's defeated. So why the food, then the fight? Why the banquet, then the battle? Why this supper before you go out and scrap?
Keeping the S's, see that? They teach a class on that in preaching school. Maybe John isn't here writing a timeline of how everything's going to unfold, but he's writing to his persecuted churches how life goes right now until he comes. Don't we eat before we fight? Next Sunday, God willing, we're going to gather and have the Lord's Supper together. Why do we have the Lord's Supper? Well, Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. Yes. What happens in your soul if the purpose of the Lord's Supper is accomplished? You're reminded who you are. You're reminded who He is. You're reminded what He's done for you, what He's doing for you, what He's going to do for you. And we are reminded that we are His people. And then what do? We get up and we go out into the world and we fight. We eat and then we fight. We remember who we are and then we go. And we don't fight against flesh and blood. We don't fight with swords and guns. We fight the good fight of faith. We fight believing that Jesus is who He says He is. We fight believing that we are who He says we are. We fight believing He's sovereign. We fight from a stance of victory. He's already won. You do know, don't you, that when you join the fight, you're just joining Jesus, who's doing it. I mean, Paul puts it this way in 1 Corinthians 10, 13. Yeah. No temptation has seized you except what is common. But every time you're tempted, this is a paraphrase, every time you're tempted, every time you enter the fight, God has already provided a way out for you. So that when you're tempted, He gives you the strength. He puts it another way in Colossians chapter 2. He talks about the effects of the cross. He says when Jesus died on the cross, He disarmed the powers and authorities in the evil world. It's done. So why food and then fight? Because that's the way we do. We remember who we are and then we go into the world and we fight the good fight of faith. Now, let me move on. What about this thousand-year stuff? Anybody that's ever studied the book of Revelation or ever had somebody talk about the book of Revelation, you've probably heard the phrase millennium. What do you believe about the millennium? Well, I'm about to tell you what you can tell them. Here's what you believe about the millennium. You're going to be so impressed. It's in chapter 20, John continues with this fighting language, but he talks about 1,000 years mixed in here. And it is literally, this 1,000-year talk has confounded scholars for 2,000 years, which is kind of bizarre. If you want to find more opinions than there are blades of grass on something, look up the millennium in Revelation chapter 20. A lot of opinions and thoughts out there. Let me show you what I mean. Look at chapter 20, verse 1. Then I saw an angel coming down from heaven holding the key to the abyss and a great chain in his hand. He seized the dragon, that ancient serpent who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. He threw him into the abyss, closed it, and put a seal on it so that he would no longer deceive the nations until 1,000 years were completed. After that, he must be released for a short time. Doesn't that just bless you? The questions abound. Is this a literal 1,000 years? What happens during the 1,000 years? When the 1,000 years are up, what's he going to be able to do? Are we on the other side of the 1,000 years? Has the 1,000 years started? Is it about to start? Maybe it'll start after this next election. A lot of people will tell you that. We could grow this church if I talked about that. You want to know what I think? You know. I don't have a clue. I don't know. But I have a thought or two as to why John put it there. Let's read on. Always helps to read the Bible. Keep reading. Verse 7. When the 1,000 years are completed, Satan will be released from his prison and will go out to deceive the nations at the four corners of the earth, Gog and Magog, to gather them for battle. Their number is like the sand of the sea. They came up across the breadth of the earth and surrounded the encampment of the saints, the beloved city. Then fire came down from heaven and consumed them. The devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Again, where's the drama? John says after 1,000 years, Satan and his minions are allowed to go, and they're going to be so many, it's going to be like the sand on the seashore. I don't know if you've been to the beach this year, but there's a lot of grains of sand, which is his way of saying there's going to be so many, and the people of God are going to seem so small that it's going to appear as if Satan and his demonic forces of evil far outweigh and are far more powerful and in much more authority than the people of God are. But just when Satan and his minions think that they're going to attack and destroy all of God and his people, fire from heaven. Have a nice day. Oh, and devil, why don't you go to the lake of fire? Oh, yeah, and the beast, y'all can go there too. 1,000 years, I don't know. I don't know what that means. But isn't this the pattern of Scripture? Isn't this the way of God to almost play a heavenly trick on Satan to make him think he's about to conquer right before the rug's pulled out from under his feet? Isn't that the way of God? I mean, think about it. In Genesis 1 and 2, everything was wonderful. And then Genesis 3, what came into the world? Starts with S, ends with N. Yeah, sin. And then 2 chapters later, all you know what has broken loose on the earth. And you got to think Satan's like, ha ha, who do you think you are, God? And then what does God do? Flood. And then you keep reading. What do you think Satan thought when Pharaoh and the Egyptians made the Israelites slaves? Ha ha! Your people are nothing. How about 10 plagues? Can I stop at 10? And then Babylon tackled, the Babylonian pagan armies tackle Israel. Take them to Babylon. Destroy Jerusalem. It's a mess. Ha ha! Then Babylon destroys itself, basically, and God raises up a remnant. And what do you think Satan felt like Friday night, that first Good Friday? He's dead. The Son of God is dead. 3 days later, Jesus conquered and overcame. I don't know what the 1,000 years means exactly, but I know that if you're a persecuted Christian, and when you think that Satan and his forces are bigger and more powerful and more than you, a word that when they overpower you, all God's got to do is send down fire from heaven to destroy them, that will bring you much encouragement and hope. And it's the way God has done things from moment one. It's beautiful. Last thing before we worship. Well, I hope we're worshiping now in our hearts, but worship through song. Why a city? And who gets to go there? Why a city in the end when all things are brought to completion? And who gets to dwell there? Let me show you where I get this. Verse 21. This will set us up to worship through song in just a few moments and set us up for next Sunday, God willing. Chapter 21, verse 1. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride, adorned for her husband. Then I heard a loud voice from the throne. Look, God's dwelling is with humanity, and he will live with them, and they will be his peoples, and God himself will be with them and will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Grief, crying, and pain will be no more, because the previous things have passed away. In the end, it's going to be a city. Why? Don't you wish he had said a beach house? And there coming out of heaven was a mansion by the waves. I do. I love beach houses. But it's a city. I go to the beach to get away from the city. Maybe a big lake house with no neighbors. Or at least a house in the woods. Nice fireplace, big screen, no calories in heaven, so whatever food you want. But he calls it a city. We try to get away from the city to go find ourselves. At least say it's the renewed Garden of Eden. I mean, that's what Adam and Eve had. But a city. Why? I'm sure there's millions of reasons. But listen, when God comes to dwell with humanity in his fullness, and the city descends upon earth like a bride adorned for her husband, those things you escape from will be gone. You won't need to escape anymore. You won't need to go away anymore. Every relationship will be perfect. Every encounter will be perfect. He doesn't remove you and I from reality, church. He redeems reality. Our God doesn't call us to escape. Our God calls us to, tells us he's going to dwell where we are. And there are hints of it now if you're paying attention. Jesus said, pray like this, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. There are moments when you are with people that love you and they know you and they know everything about you and they love you fully and you feel safe. And you get up from the table and your heart is full. There are moments. One day there won't be moments. It'll be all we know. God's dwelling is with man. And you can pray, may your kingdom come, your will be done right now as it is in heaven. And you will notice moments and you will long for this day when we will be whole. And you won't want to escape the city anymore. You won't be able to wait to get out of bed. Well, I don't know about that. God loves naps. The Bible said, be like Jesus. He took naps. Read it. Last thing. Who can dwell there? I want to go. I got to be honest. I hope I've been honest the whole time. Verse 8 of chapter 21 scares me about who can be there and who can't. Verse 8, Revelation 21. But the cowards, faithless, detestable, murderers, sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their share will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. I'm out. If that's who goes to the lake of fire, I've committed half of these a lot. And depending on how you define them, I've committed probably all of these a lot this morning. And according to Revelation 21:8, those who practice these things will be in the lake of fire and sulfur. It is the second death. And I read that and I think, I'm out. I mean, who can? But then I keep reading. It always helps to read the Bible. And let me encourage you this week to read the rest of the chapter. But listen to this. Listen what you're going to read. You're going to read that this city is called the New Jerusalem. And you're also going to read that this city has 12 gates around it. And on the 12 gates are the names of the tribes of Israel. And then you're going to read that there's 12 foundations to this city. And all 12 foundations are the names of the apostles. Weird. I mean, Moses and Elijah, I can understand, but the 12 tribes of Israel? Have you read their story recently? The story of Jacob's 12 sons? It would make Mari Povich blush. If you don't know who Mari Povich is, that's a blessing to you and yours. Don't worry about it. I mean, they did some, not PG-13, some rated R dark stuff. And that's the entrance to this city? The 12 tribes of Israel? Yeah, God chose them, but man, were they messy. And then the foundation, what we're going to stand on are the 12 apostles. Have you read the Gospels recently? You talk about some messed up guys. Faithless, not courageous, liars. They're here. And we're going to be standing on that. And then Jerusalem. Jerusalem had its moments of worship. By and large, you read about Jerusalem, there was idolatry and rebellion and sexual immorality, messed up. And yet this is the city we enter. This is the city we stand on. Who gets in? Those who know they're there. Because only God could have put them there. The ones who are in this city are in the city because they know that without God, they couldn't have anything. If you want to dwell in this new city, you don't walk in and say, "Look at what I've done." If you want to be in that city, you walk in and you say, "I am one incredible trophy of the grace of Jesus Christ." And you know, you keep reading in chapter 21 and you read about light and glory and colors, true colors and transparency. You know what I think John is saying? I think he's saying in glory, everybody's going to be able to see every little nook and cranny of our lives. And every nook and cranny of our lives is going to have stamped redeemed, changed, graced, loved. Every part of our souls is loved and changed. Every pain will be redeemed. Every sin and guilt and shame that we try to hide will be laid bare. And we'll be able to say, "Look at what Jesus did." That is incredible. And you want to be in the new city? You want to be in the new Jerusalem? You say, "Do it in me, Jesus, or I'm done." And he will do it. No wonder John stopped and worshiped this angel. The angel said, "Stop. don't worship me. Worship God. Wes Franklin, I don't know what you're hiding this morning, or I don't know what you think is unredeemable this morning, or I don't know what pain you've got this morning, but I promise you, it can and it will be transformed. And one day, Jesus, his glory, and all of us will be together, and it'll be the safest place we've ever known, and we will be able to see everything about our lives, and all of it will have been redeemed by the grace of Jesus Christ. Let Jesus redeem you. Let's worship God. Father, thank you for your word. Correct anything that I've messed up. Teach us how to worship you and to know that anything we are that has a hint of holiness and righteousness, anything, is because you have done it, are doing it, and will do it. Father, lead our hearts now to worship you in both spirit and in truth. These things I pray in the strong name of Jesus. Amen.
Stand with me. We can imagine being at the place that history is heading towards, where Christ is King, we are with him. What's the air going to be like there? What is it like when the very air that we breathe is the praise of God, is the very thing that our souls were created for? Let this song serve as a picture of what it will be like, this hymn of heaven. When you learn it, sing along with us.
And how I where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. And there will be a day we all will bow before. One voice of thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day, we'll join the resurrection and sing beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice,
Been encouraged about where this is all headed this morning. Satan is vanquished. Say it with me. And Jesus is King. Amen. Amen. Be blessed as you leave today.